Welcome to Good Friday together, as we gather to reflect and remember what Jesus did for us that we could never do for ourselves so many years ago. In our time together, the music team is going to guide us through some music with some lyrics and melodies that will allow us to reflect on the message of Good Friday. We'll also participate together in what's known as communion, a time around two elements where followers of Jesus remember the sacrifice that he made on our behalf. As you're part of the online audience right now, if you'd like to gather what elements you would deem appropriate from where you're watching to participate in that time together, you're certainly welcome to do so. You're also certainly welcome to not participate in that time together should you choose. We are so incredibly honored that you've chosen to spend this time with us. And so now, I'd like to pray for our time together as we prepare to reflect and remember the sacrifice Jesus made for us. Dear God, thank you for this time together. Thank you for the opportunity to reflect and remember on what Jesus has done for us that we could never do for ourselves. As we do this together, help each of us take a step closer in relationship to you and following Jesus. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of those who cried out for his death. Tombstones. We have all seen them. Isn't it interesting how when we pass a cemetery, we usually look? I am amazed at the different stones, the beauty of some, and the plainness of others. You might even ask yourself, who is there? As I walk through Hurricane Cemetery, there are also many tombstones I have no idea about, ones that might just say, Baby Taylor, with no name or date, or ones that have dates in the 1917s, which mean they probably passed during the last large virus to sweep this country. Some are war veterans, and some are couples married many years. Some are children, and many are adults. And some markers are so old, you cannot even read them anymore. The tombstones, though weathered and chipped, are alive with yesterday. Max Lucado talks of a tombstone that was so powerful to him because of the inscription about Grace Smith that read, Sleeps, but rests not. Loved, but was loved not. Tried to please, but pleased not. Died as she lived, alone. Let me say that again. It is very powerful. Sleeps, but rests not. Loved, but was loved not. Tried to please, but pleased not. Died as she lived, alone. Words of futility, ineffective and useless. Just reading that makes you wonder what her life was about. There were no record of her birth or death dates, but just the names of her two husbands. Futility. I wonder how many people today die in the loneliness they are living. There is a lot of loneliness today. COVID has determined that we stay away from crowds and family, and being alone is the challenge and the sadness of humanity at this time. In Scripture, there is the story of a very lonely woman whose life was futile to her. She comes to a well, and she knows the feeling of being ignored, chastised, unloved, and thrown away by humanity. She is a Samaritan, and she knows the sting of racism. She's been married to 5 different men, 5 different marriages, 5 different beds, 5 different rejections, and doors shut against her entrance. Ignored by society, and just wanting to get water at the well without causing a scene or without being seen. The tombstone for Grace Smith is the marker for the Samaritan woman. Loving, but receiving no love in return. Insignificant, unloved, and ignored. Except for an encounter with a stranger, which will change this woman's life forever. She comes to the well about noon. Most often, women came to the well in the early morning to get ready for the day, but today she was later. We don't know why, but God does. There were probably sharp tongues that waged about her, talking about her life and a turning of backs on her appearance. Not one person says a word to her, but the looks are enough to realize the disgust and hatred in the hearts of others by the well at the same time. She comes to the well, and there is a man on the ground resting against the well. She realizes he is Jewish, and no one else is around. The man asks her for water. Because of her life, she probably wonders, what does he really want? Why would a Jew ask a Samaritan for water? They talked, and he talked to her with respect. He valued her thoughts. He told her about the water that quenches the soul and not just the body. She wants this water that will keep her from being thirsty and keep her from having to come to this well. He asked her to call her husband and come back. She is hesitant. She knows that her past has been shaky, and here was a Jew that respects her and is offering what she needs. But can she tell him the truth about her life? She says she has no husband. But Jesus knows the truth. Can you imagine how anxious she must have felt? Her heart was beating fast as she lowered her head to reply with a lie by saying, I have no husband. He replies, you're right. You have had 5 husbands, and the man you are with now won't even give you his name. He does not belittle her, chastise her, but just states truth. She is amazed and asks a question from her soul. Where is God? My people say he is on the mountain. Your people say he is in Jerusalem. I don't know where he is. Wouldn't you like to see Jesus' face when he is asked this question from a 5-time divorced Samaritan woman? Did he smile? Did Did his eyes water? Did he look toward his father? To no one else but this woman did Jesus whisper the secret, I am the Messiah. See what happens? She drops her water jar, and the woman goes back to town and tells others about this encounter. Can you imagine her face? Her eyes wide with excitement, struggling for words, scrambles to her feet, runs to her town. But don't miss it. She left her water jar. She left behind the jug that had caused the sag on her shoulders. She left behind the burden she had brought. She left behind her shame and her past as she met one who thought of her as significant, knew everything she had done, and loved her anyway, Jesus the Messiah. There are two graves in this story. The first one for Grace Smith, who knew not love, and the second at the water well in a forgotten water jug. Here was buried the futility of a woman's life.
There's something big coming. I can feel it. It's like my internal compass is really honing in on true north. Jesus had just hosted us all to a powerful Passover Seder, and I could tell it was more than just a normal celebration for him and for us in other ways too. As the youngest, I got to ask all the traditional questions, and Jesus played the part of the one who knows all the answers. He didn't have to read the answers. He knew the answers even before I asked the questions. The part in the Seder about the bread and the wine referring to him was, for me, a little confusing, but then again, no one ever said that I was the sharpest of the 12. I'll get it figured out sooner or later, probably with a good bit of remedial help from the others. Right now, we're in the garden where Jesus has often brought us. He's away off with Peter, James, and John. He asked us to pray for him, something he has never asked of us before. It seemed that our arrival here touched off something in him. The joy of our fellowship has given way to some kind of fear or dread or something. I've never seen Jesus afraid, ever. So either it's just my imagination, or he really is dreading something. But what it could be, I just don't know. It's funny that I see him as dreading something while I'm excited to think that something awesome is on its way. The rest of us apostles are together, and I've got to admit, as the sun has gone down and the meal is having its effect on us, many of us are sleeping rather than praying. I'm kind of trying to do both. Sometimes my prayers are interrupted by my yawns, and sometimes my sleep is interrupted by my need to pray. I really do try to please him in every way possible, and when he asks me to do something, I try to do it to the very best of my abilities. But this praying after a full meal and after the sun has set is no easy task. All of a sudden, I see lights, torches, I guess, coming towards the garden. Looks to be a fairly sizable group. Maybe somebody else likes to come here to pray, or maybe this is a group looking for Jesus. Lots of people have so many needs, and they want Jesus to touch them or free them or pray for them or offer them encouragement or teach them as only he can. Could be that a group has gotten together and decided to come and be with Jesus after their Passover meal. And from the corner of my eye, I see Jesus coming back to where most of us have drifted off to sleep. He speaks and gently nudges each of the sleepers and tells us that it's time to wake up, that his betrayer is coming. His betrayer? He mentioned something about that at dinner just before Judas went out. I didn't know what that was all about either. The lights are getting closer, and in the broken and shifting lights and shadows, it appears that this group is made up of soldiers and some temple officials. What the heck is going on? And speak of Judas, there he is leading the group. What's he doing? Where's he been? How come I haven't missed him until this very moment? this whole thing isn't making any sense at all. I'm feeling a little uneasy. I'm sure glad I'm with Jesus and the others. Judas walks up to Jesus and gives him a kiss. Whew. Boy, my fears are calmed. It looks like perhaps Judas has brought Jesus some soldiers, maybe to begin his takeover of the government. At least that's what my heart seems to be telling me. But wait a minute. The soldiers aren't cheering Jesus. They're trying to arrest him, and us too, I think. And look at Peter. He's grabbed a sword and is slashing it at everybody who's near him. Oh my gosh, he's cut off the ear of one of the well-dressed men in the group. Angry shouts, crying, screams of uncertainty. This is getting crazy. Jesus hollers out for everyone to be calm, just like he did that time in the boat. And he kneels down and heals the wounded man's ear. Now it's getting even crazier. And now Jesus is telling the soldiers to let us disciples go, that he is the one they want, not us. And so we all begin to run. We don't know where we're going. We're just trying to get away from wherever it is that, from whatever it is that's taking place in the garden. And it occurs to me as I run that I don't know what I'm running to. I only know what I'm running away from. I'm running away from Jesus. In my fear and confusion, I took off and left Jesus alone with Judas and the soldiers. What kind of friend does that? What kind of coward am I? Finally, with a stitch in my side and needing to catch my breath, I come to a troubled stop. There are several of us here loosely assembled in the darkness, but Peter and John are missing. You can smell our sweat and our fear. The darkness of night somehow seems to be darker than usual. What in the world is going on? This is more than just unexpected. It seems to be wrong on every level. Jesus had told us that we were going to inherit 100 times more than we had given up to travel with him for these past 3 years. He had talked about us sitting on thrones and judging the tribes of Israel. He had talked again and again about his kingdom, and we had all been thoroughly convinced that what he was saying was right and it was going to happen. But now this. I can't get this to make any sense. I don't know why they arrested Jesus, and I sure don't know what Judas was doing. I'm not sure where they're going to take Jesus. It's nighttime, for crying out loud. In a way, this seemed like something demonic. As John had often said, the light of the world has come, and to my imagination, it seems that the darkness is trying to steal the light or to put it out or something. But surely the darkness can't win, can it? Is this the end of our dreams? Is this the end of our lives as we've come to know them? Is this the end of all of our hopes? Is it possible that all we have given up and been a part of has meant nothing? Was it all just foolishness on our part? My friends all questioned me when I told them 3 years ago I was going to follow Jesus because I believed him to be the Messiah. They told me they thought I was deluded. At the time, I was convinced I was right, but now my thoughts are whirling as I ponder the question, was I wrong and were they right? It didn't feel that way at all until right now. Now, just at this moment, it all seems to have been an exercise in futility. I don't know what the next hours or days will hold, but if I can stay away from the soldiers and maybe get back to Galilee, surely somehow someone will explain all this to me. At least I hope so, because right now I'm so fearful and despondent that I almost believe I could just fall down and die right here. What's going to happen to us? What's going to happen to me? What's going to happen to Jesus? What's going to happen to Judas? What's going to happen to Peter? And John, what's going to happen to him? My breathing has eased and my heart rate is approaching normal. It's time to run again and hope that somehow this is all going to turn out to be a mistake, or maybe this is all just some sort of bad dream. This just can't be the end of our ministry, can it? This just can't be the end of my new life, can it? This just can't be the end of all of our hopes and dreams about the future, can it? The questions caused me to start sobbing, and now I can't run again. The others are starting to move, most of them running into the shadows. But I'm going to have to walk and think. And I'm going to try praying to God to see if there's any answer to what's taking place. If you happen to see me walking past, would you please pray for me and for all of us disciples?
Wouldn't it be grand to come to the end of your life without regrets or fatal errors? Yes, without regrets or perceived fatal errors. Does everyone have regrets? You bet, it's part of being human and living a life in this world. Mistakes that lead to regret are where the very best of learning comes from. Like the time you cheated on the test in high school, had cheat sheets right in your desk, or a time you took just one piece of candy from the grocery store aisle. Surely they wouldn't miss just one. We all have those experiences in some form. Regret. Or the time you said something not very nice to a friend and lost that friend for a lifetime. Or you decided that the marriage you were in just wasn't fun or sexy anymore, and you wanted that I'm giddy in love feeling to be part of your life again, instead of having to just take care of your current reality. Or saw someone drop money and picked it up and went on your way. Or you blame someone else for something that you did and never apologized for the wrongdoing. Unfaithfulness, division, immorality, fatal errors. There was a letter that was addressed to the U.S. government in February of 1974 that read, I am sending $10 for blankets I stole during World War II. My mind could not rest. Sorry I'm late. Signed an XGI with a postscript that read, I want to be ready to meet God. This recruit was not alone in his guilt. His letter is one of literally thousands of letters that have been sent to the U.S. government since it began collecting and storing the letters in 1811. Since that time, $3.5 million have been deposited in what is called the Conscious Fund. It is used by people who have defrauded the U.S. government. Donations given to the Conscious Fund vary in size and reason. A 9-cent donation was made by a person from Massachusetts who had refused a 3-cent postage stamp, while a person from New Jersey sent $40,000 in several installments for $8,000 he had previously taken. Another donor sent handmade quilts in an effort to settle her tax bill. Most gifts to the Conscious Fund are from anonymous donors. Others are forwarded by clergy who have received deathbed confessions. The sincerity of some donors' repentance can be uncertain, as demonstrated by a received letter reading, Dear Internal Revenue Service, I have not been able to sleep at night because I cheated on last year's income tax. Enclosed, find a cashier's check for $1,000. If I still can't sleep, I'll send you the balance. Fulton Ousler said, Many of us crucify ourselves between two thieves, regret for the past and fear of the future. Are you there? Have you spent time in regret because of your perceived fatal errors? What do we do with our failures? Our mistakes add up over the years and we carry them around with us. The weight gets very heavy as we lug those regrets and fatal errors on our backs. We haul them around with us day after day and year after year. Sometimes there are so many, we begin to place them in a sack and carry it with us wherever we go. We eventually can only drag it rather than keep it on our back. Dragging them uphill, into daily life, into our relationships, and they plant themselves in our conscious minds. What do you do with your failures? For nothing drags more stubbornly than a sack of failures. We tell ourselves that what's in the past is done. We try to move on, forward into a new tomorrow, but the weight is still there. This is what the Apostle Paul meant when he stated that the wages of sin is death. Sin is fatal. Can we do anything about it? What do you do with the stones from life's stumbles and failures that you carry around in a sack on your back? Is it getting too heavy? Don't we all just want to be loved? We all long to be loved even though our mistakes are obvious and written on our page in the book of life? Don't we want a father who cares for us in spite of our failures? We do have that type of father. He knows your failures and loves you anyway. He knows your past and fights for your future with you every step of the way. A father who is at his best when you are at your worst. A father whose grace is strongest when our devotion is weakest. If your bag is big and bulky, if the weight is just about more than you can handle, there is some great news just for you. Your failures are not fatal.
As Jesus hung on the cross, I wonder how many of his followers were actually gathered around and what they experienced and felt as they were gathered at the cross, watching Jesus suffer and watching Jesus die, and hearing the words that Jesus exclaimed from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? I wonder, as those gathered around the cross heard those words, what echoed in their minds. I wonder for Jesus' followers if what echoed in their mind was a sense of failure. I wonder if for someone like Peter, the failure of acknowledging who Jesus was three times after Jesus' arrest echoed in his mind. I wonder if the look that Jesus gave to him after he had denied Jesus three times echoed in Peter's mind. And Peter felt the reality that not only did Jesus feel as though God had forsaken him, but he felt that Peter had forsaken him. Not that Peter was putting himself on the equivalent with God in any way, shape, or form. I wonder if the other followers of Jesus, if they were gathered there, if like James and John reflected on their failure to understand how the kingdom of God really worked when they had their mom go and ask for Jesus to allow one of them to sit on his right hand and one to sit on his left hand when he established his kingdom. And I wonder if they felt a sense of failure, that they had not done enough, that they had not been enough to help Jesus establish the kingdom that they thought he should come to establish. I wonder if all of the followers gathered there wondered what might have been, what could have been, had they only not failed in their role and in their part of helping establish Jesus as the king that they thought he should become. I wonder if they, in their minds, were hit with the echo of the sense of failure. And in a way, they were right. In a way, it was their failures that led Jesus to the cross, but not the types of failures that they had thought of. It was the type of failure that's just the result of sin, which is stepping outside of God's purposes and parameters, something all of us have done, something all of humankind have done. It's a failure that traces through all humankind, all the way back to the very first man and the very first woman who made a decision to step outside of God's purposes and parameters. They made a decision to sin. And when sin entered the world, failure entered the world. And the world was broken as the result of sin. The perfect creation that God had established was now broken and in need of redemption and in need of restoration. And it is that failure that led Jesus to the cross. It was the failure of the first man and the first woman. It was the failure of a broken world. It was the failure of every humankind that would come after the first man and the first woman. It was the failure of the followers of Jesus. I wonder if for them they went back to the night Jesus was arrested and felt that sense of failure all over again. When the Roman soldiers and the Jewish religious leaders came to arrest Jesus, and all of his followers shrunk back from Jesus rather than rallied around Jesus. I wonder what that failure felt like for them as they saw Jesus on the cross and heard those words, my God, why have you forsaken me? I wonder sometimes if we don't struggle with a specific failure more than the failure of our sin that led Jesus to the cross. For each and every one of us, there are specific failures. But there's also the reality of the failure of sin that has permeated our world and infected our lives. And it is the reality of that sin that needs to be redeemed and the relationship with God that needs to be restored that led Jesus to the cross. Not just the first man and woman, not just the people before us, not just the followers of Jesus of his day when he spent his time on earth, but our sin, our failures, is what led Jesus to the cross. And so today, as we reflect and remember on Jesus' death, we must also acknowledge and know that it is our failures that led him there. But even more so, it is his great love and God's great love for us, just as we are in our brokenness, in our failure, in our sin. But the love that he loves too much, loves us too much to leave us that way, that led Jesus to the cross. And so on the one hand, while we're heartbroken over the result of our failures and sin, we are also overwhelmed with God's great love and God's great grace, which led Jesus to the cross.
Deep as my soul, my He was uneasy. He had been since noon. It wasn't the death that troubled him. The centurion was no stranger to finality. Over the years, he'd grown callous to the screams of the crucified. He'd mastered the art of numbing his heart. But this crucifixion plagued him. The day began as 100 others, dreadfully. It was bad enough to be in Judea, but it was hell to spend a hot afternoon on a rocky hill supervising the death of pickpockets and rabble-rousers. Half the crowd taunted, half cried. The soldiers griped, the priests bossed. It was a thankless job in a strange land. He was ready for the day to be over before it even began. He was curious at the attention given to the flat-footed peasant. He smiled as he read the sign that would go on the cross. The condemned looked anything but a king. His face was lumpy and bruised. His back arched slightly and his eyes faced downward. "Some harmless hick," mused the centurion. "What could he have done?" Then Jesus raised his head. He wasn't angry. He wasn't uneasy. His eyes were strangely calm as they stared from behind the bloody mask. He looked at those who knew him, moving deliberately from face to face as if he had a word for each one. For just a moment, he looked at the centurion. For a second, the Roman looked into the purest eyes he'd ever seen. He didn't know what the look meant, but the look made him swallow and his stomach feel empty. As he watched the soldier grab the Nazarene and yank him to the ground, something told him this is not going to be a normal day. As the hours wore on, the centurion found himself looking more and more at the one on the center cross. He didn't know what to do with the Nazarene's silence. He didn't know what to do with his kindness. But most of all, he was perplexed by the darkness. He didn't know what to do with the black sky in mid-afternoon. No one could explain it. No one even tried. 1 minute the sun, the next darkness. 1 minute the heat, the next a chilly breeze. Even the priests were silenced. For a long while, the centurion sat on a rock and stared at the three silhouetted figures. Their heads were limp, occasionally rolling from side to side. The jeering was silent, eerily silent. But those who had wept now waited. Suddenly, the center head ceased to bob. It yanked itself erect. Its eyes opened in a flash of white. A roar sliced the silence. "It is finished." It wasn't a yell. It wasn't a scream. It was a roar, a lion's roar. From what world that roar came, the centurion didn't know, but he knew it wasn't this one. The centurion stood up from the rock and took a few paces towards the Nazarene. As he got closer, he could see that Jesus was staring into the sky. There was something in his eyes that the soldier had to see. But after only a few steps, he fell. He stood, fell again. The ground was shaking, gently at first and now violently. He tried once more to walk and was able to take only a few steps and then fall again, at the foot of the cross. He looked up into the face of the one near death. The king looked down on the crusty old centurion. Jesus' hands were fastened. They couldn't reach out. His feet were nailed to timber. They couldn't walk toward him. His head was heavy with pain. He could scarcely move it, but his eyes, they were afire. They were unquenchable. They were the eyes of God. Perhaps that's what made the centurion say what he said. He saw the eyes of God. He saw the same eyes that had seen a near-naked adulteress in Jerusalem, a friendless divorcee in Samaria, and a 4-day dead Lazarus in a cemetery. The same eyes that didn't close upon seeing man's futility, didn't turn away at man's failure, and didn't wince upon witnessing man's death. "It's all right," God's eyes said. "I've seen the storms, and it's still all right." The centurion's conviction began to flow together like rivers. "This is no carpenter," he spoke under his breath. "This was no peasant. This was no normal man." He stood and looked around at the rocks that had fallen and the sky that had blackened. He turned and stared at the soldiers as they stared at Jesus, with frozen faces. He turned and watched as the eyes of Jesus lifted and looked toward home. He listened as parched lips parted and the swollen tongue spoke for the last time. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Had the centurion not said it, the soldiers would have. Had the centurion not said it, the rocks would have, as would have the angels, the stars, even the demons. But he did say it. It fell to a nameless foreigner to state what they all knew. Surely this man was the Son of God. 6 hours on one Friday. 6 hours that jut up on the plain of human history like Mount Everest in a desert. 6 hours that have been deciphered, dissected, and debated for 2,000 years. What do those 6 hours signify? They claim to be the door in time through which eternity entered man's darkest caverns. They mark the moments that the navigator descended into the deepest water to leave anchor points for his followers. What does that Friday mean? For the life blackened with failure, that Friday means forgiveness. For the heart scarred with futility, that Friday means purpose. And for the soul looking into this side of the tunnel of death, that Friday means deliverance. 6 hours, one Friday. What do you do with those 6 hours on that Friday?
When Jesus hung on the cross, the biblical narrative tells us that he uttered the words, "It is finished." And then he breathed his last and gave up his spirit. The words, "It is finished," sound like they come with a great deal of finality. And I have to wonder what finality those words came with. It was obviously the end of Jesus' life on earth. But was it the end of Jesus' work on earth? Was it the end of what he came to do? Was that finished when he breathed his last and gave up his spirit? It's not a cut and dry scenario. It is the end of his sacrifice for sin. In his death, the payment for sin is finished. The path to right relationship with God that overcomes sin is finished. But the work he came to do is not finished. The work he came to do was to reach all of humankind with God's grace. So there would be people who would live after Jesus' death, after he uttered the words, "It is finished." And so the work is continuing. The work is ongoing. And as Jesus hung on the cross and uttered the words, "It is finished," part of me wonders what those gathered around the cross experienced and what they felt. For his followers, I wonder if they felt like their work was finished. But the reality is their work had only begun. I wonder if they felt like all that they had staked their lives on, all that they had left to follow Jesus, all that they had hoped and dreamed of was finished. That all of it had come crashing down when Jesus uttered those words. But the reality is, their work was just beginning. I wonder, for the Jewish religious leaders who were gathered there watching Jesus died, when he uttered the words, "It is finished," I wonder if they felt like what was finished was the nuisance that Jesus had caused for them, was the life of someone who posed a threat to them and their way of life. But the reality is that even though Jesus uttered, "It is finished," the work that God would do was still to continue. I wonder what the crowd, the people who were just kind of bystanders in the process. I wonder what they felt and what they wondered about what was finished. The Roman trial was over. The walk from the Via Dolorosa was over. I mean, all of that was over. It was finished. It was done. And I wonder for them what they wondered was next. The reality is, for each and every one of them, the work that God was doing in their lives had only just begun. The biblical narrative tells us about one Roman soldier who, when Jesus died, when he uttered these words, the Roman soldier said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." In the way that Jesus died, there was something that connected for this Roman soldier to identify Jesus as the very Son of God, sent to the world in a human form, to die on a cross and pay the price and become the sacrifice to redeem sin and to provide the path to right relationship with God. And as we ponder, as we reflect, and as we remember the words, "It is finished," that Jesus uttered before breathing his last and giving up his spirit, I hope we can ponder and maybe even embrace that surely this man was the Son of God. As we prepare to take communion together, the music team is going to lead us in a song. And as they lead us in this song, reflect on the words. Reflect on Jesus uttering, "It is finished," breathing his last, and giving up his spirit. And maybe, just maybe, ponder that Jesus surely is the Son of God.
Jesus shed for me. What a sound.
When Jesus hung on the cross, the biblical narrative tells us that he uttered the words, "It is finished." And then he breathed his last and gave up his spirit. The words, "It is finished," sound like they come with a great deal of finality. And I have to wonder what finality those words came with. It was obviously the end of Jesus' life on earth, but was it the end of Jesus' work on earth? Was it the end of what he came to do? Was that finished when he breathed his last and gave up his spirit? It's not a cut and dry scenario. It is the end of his sacrifice for sin. In his death, the payment for sin is finished. The path to right relationship with God that overcomes sin is finished. But the work he came to do is not finished. The work he came to do was to reach all of humankind with God's grace. So there would be people who would live after Jesus' death, after he uttered the words, "It is finished." And so the work is continuing. The work is ongoing. And as Jesus hung on the cross and uttered the words, "It is finished," part of me wonders what those gathered around the cross experienced and what they felt. For his followers, I wonder if they felt like their work was finished. But the reality is their work had only begun. I wonder if they felt like all that they had staked their lives on, all that they had left to follow Jesus, all that they had hoped and dreamed of was finished, that all of it had come crashing down when Jesus uttered those words. But the reality is their work was just beginning. I wonder, for the Jewish religious leaders who were gathered there watching Jesus die, when he uttered the words, "It is finished," I wonder if they felt like what was finished was the nuisance that Jesus had caused for them, was the life of someone who posed a threat to them and their way of life. But the reality is that even though Jesus uttered, "It is finished," the work that God would do was still to continue. I wonder what the crowd, the people who were just kind of bystanders in the process, I wonder what they felt and what they wondered about what was finished. The Roman trial was over. The walk from the Via Dolorosa was over. I mean, all of that was over. It was finished. It was done. And I wonder for them what they wondered was next. The reality is, for each and every one of them, the work that God was doing in their lives had only just begun. The biblical narrative tells us about one Roman soldier who, when Jesus died, when he uttered these words, the Roman soldier said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." In the way that Jesus died, there was something that connected for this Roman soldier to identify Jesus as the very Son of God, sent to the world in a human form, to die on a cross and pay the price and become the sacrifice to redeem sin and to provide the path to right relationship with God. And as we ponder, as we reflect, and as we remember the words, "It is finished," that Jesus uttered before breathing his last and giving up his spirit, I hope we can ponder and maybe even embrace that surely this man was the Son of God. As we prepare to take communion together, the music team is going to lead us in a song. And as they lead us in this song, reflect on the words. Reflect on Jesus uttering, "It is finished," breathing his last, and giving up his spirit. And maybe, just maybe, ponder that Jesus surely is the Son of God.
I'm
Well, thank you again for choosing to spend Good Friday together with us. It's an incredible story of God's grace and God's love extended to a world that includes people like me and people like you that has been broken by sin. And one of the really cool things is that Good Friday isn't even the end of the story. There's so much more to the story that comes on the third day, which is what we know now as Easter Sunday, which is often commonly referred to as Resurrection Sunday. And so whether this was your first time with us or first time in a long time, we hope that you'll choose to connect with us again on Sunday at 10 a.m. for the continuation of the story. We all live in the in-between, and we'll unpack that and uncover that, and we hope that you'll be a part of it. We hope that this time and the next time helps you take a step in relationship with God and following Jesus.